go after the story of one of the most extraordinary men of our time. You see him behind me? Perhaps the greatest architect of the 20th century, and in the opinion of some, America's foremost social rebel. According to a story in Life magazine not many years back, his fellow architects have called him everything from a great poet to an insupportable windbag. The clergy has deplored his morals, creditors have deplored his financial habits, politicians his opinions. Admirers feel him as a man 100 years ahead of his time.
Many of you only know me as the greatest American architect of all time, but there is more to my notable structures that made me the greatest. It was on June 8, the year 1867, William and Anna, my parents, welcomed me, their first child, at a farming town of Richland Center in Wisconsin and named me Frank Lincoln Wright. Father was a locally admired orator, music teacher, occasional lawyer and an itinerant minister. Mother is a county school teacher. Mother said that when she was expecting me, I would grow up to build beautiful buildings. She even decorated my room with engravings of English cathedrals torn from a periodical. After I turned 14, my parents separated. Mother turned unhappy with my father's inability to provide for us. Mother even asked father to leave. And from that day on, never heard from him again. Never. As the only male left in the family, I assumed financial responsibility for my mother and my two sisters. At this time, I changed my name to Frank Lloyd Wright. In 1887, I arrived in Chicago in search of employment. I was hired as a draftsman with the architectural firm of Joseph Lyman Silsby. But feeling a little underpaid for the quality of my works for Silsby, I quit and found a new work at a new firm. However, I realized that I wasn't ready to be on my own. I returned to Silsby. This time with raised salary. On 1888, I met Catherine Lee Tobin. Kitty, for short, during activities at All Souls Church. June 1, 1889, I married her. I was just 22 then when I designed and built the house for my wife in Oak Park. My apprenticeship with Louis Sullivan served me well and made my mark. Sullivan also did his part to facilitate the financial success of my marriage. First, marriage. Mama Borthwick Cheney was a modern woman with interest. In 1909, even before the Robbie House was completed, Mama Cheney and I eloped to Europe. My emotion affected my life as I wrote, "I am a house divided against itself by circumstances I cannot control." On a fine noon on August 15, 1914, it was a Saturday when Cheney sat down to lunch with her two children and several workers from the estate. Julian Carlton, a servant who had been threatened with dismissal, was due to serve them. Instead, he poured paraffin around the building, locked all the doors, set fire to the house, then proceeded to hatchet 7 of the 9 occupants to death. Cheney and the children died in that tragedy. I was devastated. All I had left to show for the struggle for freedom of the 5 years past that had swept most of my former life away had now been swept away. I moved out and shared spaces with Robert C. Spencer Jr., Myron Hunt, and Dwight H. Perkins. Early 1910s, several architects and many of my employees launched their careers in the offices of Steinway Hall. November 1923, after my divorce from Kitty became final, I married Miriam Noel, a Bohemian clairvoyant and fantasist whom I first met in 1914. Our marriage was short and tempestuous, and after her behavior became increasingly erratic, I discovered she was a morphine addict. Later, in the divorce proceedings, I was accused of beating her and calling her vile, vulgar, indecent, and abusive. Olgivana Heisenberg, a mystic and dancer from Montenegro, had followed her first husband to Chicago to sue for divorce. She already had a daughter, Svetlana, but was soon pregnant with my child. There will always be a fascination with the private life of a man who lives so large. The novelist Boyle, for example, became interested in me after he bought a prairie house designed by me in 1909. His new work tells the story of my three wives and Jenny. And after months of research, Boyle feels he understands with his subject better. Was he just a womanizer? I don't think so. He needed challenging, attractive woman by his side. He could only create with his back against the wall, and his relationships were essential to his work. As to whether his novel rakes up old dirt, Boyle is adamant that the architect's genius will always win through. My book only adds to the sum of the legend. What really matters is that he made great buildings. Nothing can detract from that.